The next keynote speaker is doctoral candidate under the direction of Professor Horsch. His key activities focuses on two areas, vocational and university candidates, didactics and examination in theoretical vocational education. He is the executive director of the Association for the Promotion of Education and Training for Professional Educators at the TU Dresden. Now he is going to address us on the issue of engineering pedagogy at universities in Saxony, insights into research and further education project of TU Dresden. Let's welcome Mr. Marco Keller.
I think I need a little bit more space. First, I want to outline my speech. I want to start with the project background and explain a little bit the aim of the project, to explain the structure of the project, and some research results from the first project phase, closely to the speech of Professor Horsch. This is followed by the structure of the curriculum we already have seen. And out of this structure of the curriculum, I take one module 1.3, communication in engineering education. This module I want to explain in more detail and concrete the point understanding and communication in written examinations as key aspect of module 1.3. So we can start with the project background on the project eDidact, engineering didact. In this background, we have to distinguish two matters. Two matters about target groups. These matters can't thought separately, but we have to distinguish both to work with the target group and identify the target group and develop a special content, special curriculum for them. Of course, we need both. We need engineering students and we need university teachers. Without students, no teacher, and without teacher, no student. Matter one, the requirements for future engineers with regard to social communicative activity in modern structures of production and service, and design of teaching and learning processes to the development of adequate qualifications. This is the target group, the engineering students. I think Professor Horsch said the one and the other point to this matter, and I want to focus matter two, because this was also the focus of the project. Yeah. Here we see a design of needs-based engineering education, especially design of technical and technological specific teaching and learning in academic engineering education. This means engineering pedagogy in the context of our project. The starting point in Germany, Saxony, of course, we realized this project, were also explained a little bit by the speaker. Yes. So I won't, I'm don't going to explain it in detail. Maybe some words on it. In Germany, we have a great discussion about skills shortage in many different professions. One profession which is especially focused are engineers. Professor Hodge showed already about 100,000 engineers we need per year. And on the other side, maybe in different universities, about 50% of students who don't pass the final examinations. These students under certain circumstances, are very valuable for vocational education, but this is not the focus of our project. Our focus of our project is to stop the decreasing number of graduates in engineering study courses. We want to increase these numbers. Therefore, we started the project, as already shown. Last aspect on this slide, modern academic teaching demands changes in teaching arrangements to allow more autonomous learning activity in didactic teaching and learning designs. I want to give one or two examples on this point. On the one hand, we have to respect and recognize the heterogeneity of students, autonomous learning styles, and so on, cultural specialties. On the other side, we see development of media in different professions and in different educations, in different study courses. Here we have to, this we also have to respect in our thinking, in our development, in designing study courses. These are over some of the starting points, I think the main starting points in Saxony for our project. If we have a little bit more focus on the project structure, we see in the project aim, the aim of the project was on the one hand to develop, to implement, and to test a tailor-made science-based study course to both meet the market requirements and to develop competencies by designing teaching and learning processes for academic engineering education. In this project, we subdivided three phases. First phase, we had analyze phase of the needs of engineering teaching staff and lecturers. There take place interviews with different professors from universities in Saxony, with lecturers, and we ask them, how do you design your lecturers, your seminars, and so on? Which changes do you recognize in the last year? What do you think, what is necessary to develop, to change in curriculum and in education belonging didactical knowledge for academic staff? This phase was followed by the development of a curriculum we already have seen. And this curriculum we implemented at our model University of Applied Science in Zittau-Görlitz. We tested this curriculum with our target group, with scientific staff, with professors and with lecturers of different engineering study courses. In parallel, we evaluated and modified this curriculum to make it even more closer to the needs of our target group. Here we see exemplarily some results from the first phase of the project. First phase of the project means the analysis of the needs of the teaching staff. We have to distinguish two target groups. On the one hand, teaching staff with university didactical education, and on the other hand, teaching staff without university didactical education. First target group contains mostly professors who were at this university already in former GDR, because there were obligate education in academic pedagogic and academic didactic, but not only from the former GDR, but in our sample we found the one or the other who talk about that. We see this problem, qualification of didactic of academic stuff in problems of didactic and pedagogy takes place not only from time to time, it takes place in a globalized world today, again, you know, on many different places and many different countries of the world. We see the needs which I focus here are very special. These are not basic and basic principles they wanted to know, but these are specialized in different points of their lectures. For example, the use of special types of teaching and learning in engineering education, or special problems, not basic problems, special problems in designing examination processes. Last point we see, evaluating study courses is a more modern problem. Our interview partners weren't so much in touch with this topic. So they mentioned they need education in it. On the other hand, we see teaching stuff without university didactical education. And here, these people we interviewed were mostly young lecturers, PhD students, who had to design their own lectures, their own seminars, their own internships, and so on. Yeah. And they said, we need didactic basics in planning and performing and analyzing academic education processes. We need information about selecting and designing of didactic media. We don't know on which criteria we have to select media in our lectures. The designing of communicative processes, a very special theme in education of engineers. This I want to focus in the second part of my speech. The control and evaluating of learning results using didactic methods in study courses. Which didactic methods are they? Are there? Many of them didn't have any idea of this. And last but not least, structuring of study courses itself. To get an overview over the whole topic. Here we see the structure of the curriculum again. A little bit in another way than in the speech of Professor Hodge, but content is the same. We see we have four modules. The curriculum starts with fundamentals of designing and teaching and learning processes. And here we have different units, planning and of learning and teaching processes, selecting and design of media, communication in engineering processes. I marked the screen because we have a look at it in detail on the next slides. And at last, control and evaluation of learning results. These are the basic principles they had to know, we wanted to teach, and then we could add on module two. Here, an arrangement of academic teaching and learning. You see units, design of lectures and seminars. To design lectures and seminars, participants have to know basic principles of planning and learning of teaching processes, and so on. Also, this is also the case for design of exercise and laboratory internships and the design of engineering internships and research colloquia. Module 2 is followed by a module level named structuring of study programs to get an overview how to study, how to design study courses, which criteria I have to recognize. Determining of employment-oriented study object, determining of appropriate study content. Module 1 to 3 is, also mentioned by Professor Hodge, the theoretical part of our study course, of our curriculum. Parallel to it, we see we have a practical part. Practical part means we have coaching phase. We work with case studies, with the participants, internal and external observation, evaluation of yourself and by colleagues. And at the in the end of our curriculum, we have a concluding colloquium. Let's have a closer look at Unit 1.3, Communication in Engineering Processes. The aim of the module, can you see here? The participants are qualified in this design teaching, design teaching relevant communication processes. Communicate with their students purposeful and adequately under consideration of scientific knowledge about communication on one hand, and on the other hand, personality traits of their communication skills. And here we see we have the connection to the analyzed needs of our target groups. The personal traits of their communication skills means an interaction between student and lecturer, or on the other hand, that means interaction between engineer and his customer. This is the overall aim of the module, and considering this, you see there are 5 units in the module. In which different communicative key aspects are contained. First, basic in designing communicative processes. The second is green again, because I want to have a closer look at it. Next slide. Teaching relevant monological communicative processes, followed by teaching relevant dialogical communicative processes. The difference between both I show you in the next slide. Unit 4, conflict management. Conflict basics in conflict management are very important at university between student and teacher and lecturer, because if we say students are able to be autonomous, we have to recognize that they go another way than teacher goes. And so there may be conflicts between both. On the other hand, conflicts between colleagues, conflicts between students, conflicts between engineer and customer, conflicts between engineer and his team. Conflict management is in the other field but they have to deal with it in the modern time. So here you can find, and here they can try out how to handle it, or how to work, how to deal with conflicts. And Unit 5, basics in intercultural communication. I think this is not so difficult to understand. Basics in intercultural communication means we live in a globalized world, work together, intercultural, transcultural, and in this unit they learn basics about this focus, this topic. How to interact with people from Thailand, maybe, from Asia, from USA, and so on and so on. Here you can see, for example, the difference between monological communicative procedures and dialogical communicative procedures. The aim of the unit teaching relevant monological communicative procedures, participants are qualified to characterize specific communicative procedures, to characterize it, and they are able to structure monological communicative procedures and perform them adequately. On the one hand, characterize something, on the other hand, to perform something to work with. Second unit, or up the other unit, teaching relevant dialogical communicative procedures. That means participants are qualified to analyze written argumentations considering their characteristics of truth, and they are able to structure their choice of words and argue in conversations under consideration of specific communicative design elements. Here you see the difference between monological and dialogical is monological communicative communication way, there is no communication partner. It's mostly asynchronous communication. For example, in written examinations, you write a task students have to solve, and so it's not synchronous. If you talk with somebody, you have dialogical communicative procedures. You can react immediately. The next slides I want to show, or I want to explain a little bit more in detail some contents we teach in this first part in monological communicative procedures. The content of the module is first, we can divide between basic principles and specialized contents. First, process, structures, and dialogues, characteristics, and performance spectrum of specific teaching relevant communication procedures. What is the difference between, for example, analyzing and explaining? What is the difference between developing a structure and describing a structure? This is content of this first point. Second point, didactic principles in monological communicative procedures. And third, screen again, I want to go deeper, communication in written examinations. These are basics in this unit, followed by specialized content, for example, planning of speeches and presentations, for example, paths of cognition, and not only the verbal part of communication, but also paraverbal and nonverbal part of communication. Here we have a connection to intercultural communication, of course. The nonverbal communication in Asia is very different from that in Europe. And people or students and participants have to recognize that, have to work with it, and have to learn about these facts. In the next slides, I want to speak about communication in written examinations, especially about understanding and communication in written examinations as key aspect of module 1.3. The starting point of this content change demands in tasks in examinations in engineering education. That means tasks in examinations become more and more complex and require competencies to solve problems. Not only to name problems or to name facts, no, to recognize a problem and to solve it, to develop different strategies to solve a problem or a given problem. This is the need, and on the other hand, we see there's often an imbalance of different cognitive levels in control and evaluation of learning results. There is often asked too much of students, and the result are poor marks in examinations. But this is not a problem. This is the result, is the problem for students. The origin is a mistake, the fault on the side of the teachers. So I think it's necessary to have some fundamental thoughts about this topic. First, learning without language is impossible. We can see a different spoken language, written language, symbols, letters, and so on. But language is needed to learn. Since more than 1,000 years, or every time. In lectures, in seminars, a teacher uses language, especially for initiate, regulate learning processes, and in the end, get feedback about the learning status. Therefore, he needs language. So teaching and learning, not only in engineering education, but here it is our topic, teaching and learning in education can be defined as a language-based relationship between teacher and student. We have to consider this in the next steps. The understanding of oral and written information in engineering education is fundamental for the learning process, especially for the acquiring and structuring of knowledge. This we know from cognitive psychology. And on the other hand, for controlling and evaluating learning results. And these are only two of more main topics. But these are the key aspects we think about in the next minutes. To make it a little bit more clear, here you see a model of communication. I think people who published this model, you know much more better than me. Shannon and Weaver, 1976. Shannon and Weaver were electronical engineers. They wanted to show with this model the communication between engines, respective parts of engines. Let's have a closer look at this. We have a sender, and on the other side we have a receiver. Maybe two engines, or student and teacher. The sender encodes an information. This information through a medium to the receiver, and the receiver has to decode it. After decoding, he encodes a feedback and sends this feedback through this medium to this origin sender, and he also has to decode it. This is a known problem in engineering, I think. If you want to write some programs for CNC machines and engines, you have to recognize that there can be this can be come to problems. In the communication between teacher and learner, let's have a closer look. KA is the set of linguistic signs which A uses. For example, the teacher, A, is our teacher. EA, smaller circle, is a set of linguistic signs whose meanings A knows. For example, I can use the term theory of relativity, but I don't know what it is about. I can use this term, but I can't ask questions about it, except what is behind this. The same we have on the side of the receiver. KB is the set of linguistic signs which B uses, and E of EB is a set of linguistic signs whose meanings B knows. And now, this is our interesting point. This area, you see, A and B is the set of linguistic signs whose meanings A and B use, knows, and the structures area is the set of linguistic signs which A and B know and which get an identical meaning by A and B. For example, I can give you an example. I have a special understanding of competency or special understanding or understanding of quality of lectures. And I'm sure it differs from your understanding of quality of lectures. Of course, there are other criteria standing behind it. Professor Hodge said in his speech before, it's very important to define terms in the first step. To talk about what we communicate about. This is the only one model of communication. I think it's one of the simplest one. In the meantime, there were many more models developed. Yeah? But this one is it's good enough to explain this circumstances and this facts I told with the linguistic signs and especially the identical meaning. The intention of this unit is to enhance transparency of examination processes and a more adequate design of task and written examinations in engineering education. The approach we followed is the explication of operators used in written tasks during lectures. Under operators, we understand verbs which prompt a specific act. Prompt a specific act on side of the student. For example, if you write a task which is, please analyze this model of communication. Analyze, in this task, analyze is the operator. Second point, the teaching of the meaning of operators to improve a common understanding for teacher and learner. This is the approach. And to realize this approach, we describe didactic orders. Didactic orders as an instrument to improve a common understanding. Didactic orders means, didactic orders are verbal initiatives given by teacher, which have different levels of intensity and prompt students to act with a learning relevant object in an expected or defined way. And didactic orders contain verbal encoded information that have been planned with regards to phases of instruction They are used to prompt an expected specific act during the learning process. And here we have operators are frequently used in didactic orders, maybe in a direct or in an indirect way. So it is the main point, the key aspect to work with. And operators represent different cognitive levels. We see close connection, first speech, to reproduce, to produce, and to solve problems, to transform knowledge. If you choose the operator to these levels, you can balance in your examinations, in the tasks in your examinations, the different cognitive levels, and the danger to ask the students too much, too difficult questions, slows down. And the last point, the clarity of operators is necessary to improve a common understanding of tasks and examinations and get valid learning results. That means the teacher has to talk about with his students what does he understand under each operator he uses. For example, what does he mean with analyze, what does he mean with describing, with developing, and so on and so on. If students know this, they can work with these operators. They know what they have to do in the task. And think about, there are not only tasks, there are also questions, or incomplete tasks, or problems they have to work with. And so it's very necessary that it is clear what is behind the operator. How have they to work with them? I think these are some explanations about only one part of one module of this curriculum we developed in this engineering pedagogy project. I think for next time this should be enough. If you have questions on this, I would be glad to answer it. And thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Mr. Keller, for an excellent speech, especially on communication on engineering education. Anyone have question? Please.
ครับมีคำถามครับหรือข้อเสนอแนะความคิดเห็นก็ได้นะครับแสดงว่าเข้าใจดีแล้วครับครับก็ขอขอบคุณนะครับดร.แคนดิเดตมาร์คเคลเลอร์นะครับที่มาให้ข้อมูลความรู้ต่างๆกับพวกเราในวันนี้ครับแล้วกันนี้ครับขอเรียนเชิญท่านคณบดีครับมอบของที่ระลึกให้กับผู้นำการอภิปรายครับ
Thank you for our keynote speakers and I'm sure that everyone appreciates that a lot. May the dean present gift to our keynote speaker, please.